Let's go back now to our main story this evening and the sharp falls in global stock markets following warnings about the economic outlook.
Yes, for more on this, we're joined now by Vicky Price, who's Senior Managing Director of FTI Consulting and former Joint Head of the Government Economic Service, and Mariana Mazzucato, who's Professor of Economics of Innovation at the Open University. Ladies, thanks very much indeed for joining us. First of all, Vicky, it seems as if the current problems that we're having globally, economically, are down to the fact that there's not enough growth in any of the major economies, whereas perhaps in 2008 it was all about deficits. Is that what we're seeing?
I'm afraid that's true. What has happened, of course, is that a number of countries have been trying to achieve fiscal consolidation after having to spend a lot more to get out of the recession, of course, with the result that governments are certainly not helping in terms of getting growth to move again. There is a lot of reliance on the private sector responding and reacting to different conditions, particularly low interest rates, and therefore investing and hopefully also exporting. That is very hard to do if all countries are trying to do the same thing and if they're all not growing particularly fast.
And Professor Mazzucato, lots we're hearing that there needs to be decisive global action. What form should that decisive action take at this stage?
Well, in fact, what they've said in the letter is that we should be looking to increase global demand and confidence. And what they mean by confidence is, if you want, Keynesian animal spirits in the private sector. And in fact, fiscal consolidation does not do that. In the UK, Mervyn King, I think it was in June, announced that the budget cuts were going to cause a household demand to basically freeze for the next 5 years. And the Institute for Fiscal Studies has also just reported last week that the cuts have decreased real household income by 10%, so the living standards of people. How is that in this country, for example, going to increase demand? And then if you bring that worldwide, because unfortunately many countries are following these same austerity packages. And Greece, by the way, in fact, Vicky is Greek, so she might want to say something, and I'm Italian, and Greece and Italy currently are in the media. Both Greece and Italy have, you know, serious problems, but why? It is not just about the deficit. It's about 10 years in Italy of low productivity, low spending in R&D. So in fact, this austerity package, which will be stuffed down their throat, will probably make all those structural problems much worse, because it's a problem in the real economy.
Sure. Okay, Vicky, then, we've got a fundamental ideological logjam here, then, haven't we? Do you cut deficits exclusively at the risk of not having enough growth? Or do you pump money into the economy and government works and all that kind of stuff, increase growth to a degree? And as a result, because this is a fundamental ideological debate, that's why the logjam is so stubborn and has been going on for weeks and weeks and weeks. We've seen it in the US Congress with Washington, with the President and Congress. We've seen it in the European Union. Should there be more political integration and so on? It's a fundamental ideological problem here. And as a result, these are issues that we're not going to resolve quickly.
Well, I think there's an element of truth in that, but we have to bear in mind that, of course, the countries with deficits and big debts, not so much with deficits, but with big debts, that's the thing that really matters, need to go out of into the markets and borrow in order to cover those debts. So the real problem is that if you carry on having those deficits, which then, of course, need to be funded, therefore your debt increases inevitably, having those deficits stay very high is a real problem in terms of being able to sustain any sort of ability to borrow in the markets.
But that's my point. I mean, yes, fundamentally, for the Republicans in Congress, it is about cutting the deficit, nothing else. And for a Democratic Party, it's about, it's that old Keynesian argument, it's about growth.
Well, I think the interesting thing is, from an economic viewpoint, you absolutely need growth. Otherwise, you're just not going to be able to even meet your debt repayments nobody wants to lend to you at reasonable rates. I think for a while, the world economy was able to, particularly Europe, was able to sustain high debt ratios to GDP, basically because interest rates were very low and because nobody thought those countries were going to default. The moment interest rates start going up and you're not growing, as a country like Italy, for example, which has had this problem, or Greece, then immediately you have a problem. And there are two ways of addressing it. I mean, I presume one is to just default, say, I just can't do this. The second one is to do something quite dramatic about reducing your deficit and therefore being able to meet your debt. Now, it's not very easy to do that. These dramatic changes just don't happen overnight. Reform takes a long time. And I think what has happened in terms of this ideology that you're talking about is that we have sort of borrowed the IMF ideology. It's changing its tune a bit, I think, under Lagarde a bit, which says you've got to come back or cut back. Austerity is the name of the game. Rather than looking at long-term sustainable reform which might actually bring those countries back to growth.
Sure. Mariana Mazzucato, what do they do at this stage in the game? We're just hearing from Vicky Pryor that reform takes a long time. We've heard from Christine Lagarde today that we don't have a long time now. You know, time is of the essence.
Sure. Well, it's interesting that one of the signatories of the letter is the president of Korea. And in fact, Korea and the UK right now are following very different paths, and this comes back down to the ideological question. So it's not just about Keynesian spending, it's about targeted spending. And Korea, for example, is spending a lot. I think it's third, and I think Japan is first, Finland is second in terms of green investments. So the UK is talking about being the greenest government ever, this current government. And in fact, the spending is, I think I read last, that the amount of money that this country spends in environmental technologies is less than what it spends on furniture. Okay, whereas Korea is bang on with China, with Germany, doing the Keynesian stimulus package, but again, targeted around those particular sectors, which we hope will be the next big thing after the internet. That's what causes growth.
Well, this and Germany, take time, yeah. Of course. I mean, this thing takes time, and that's the thing. And we need to explain also the letter we're referring to is the letter sent to Sarkozy, basically, yeah, because right, he's now the sort of head of the G20, which I think you probably mentioned earlier. By the likes of the UK, of course, who particularly want to see the Eurozone problem solved, because if the Eurozone doesn't really grow as fast as we'd like it to.
So,
absolutely, because, I mean, there is a real issue. Our markets, our export markets, are the ones that are suffering quite significantly as a result of the debt problems that have been created during the recession.
But time is an issue. So Germany, after the crisis, increased its R&D spending by 8%. This country decreased it by 10%. Okay, so and Germany is growing, the UK is not.
Although even Germany is beginning to really suffer right now, because the latest figures suggest that, in fact, we're seeing quite a dramatic slowdown.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, we'll leave it there. Vicky Pryce, Professor Mariana Mazzucato, it's great to have you.
Thanks
for joining us.
Good to see you. Thank you.
Now the family.